today, in this lecture, we would have some idea regarding the Sufi, Bhakti, as well as the Sanyasi movement. Since the Sufi movement was important and we have already discussed about it in the previous lecture, today we would concentrate on the Bhakti and most particularly on the Sanyasi movement. So far as the Bhakti movement is concerned, this was started during the Sultanate period, and there were several Bhakti leaders, Bhakti saints, who were very active during that period. We know the name of Kabir, Guru Nanak, Surdas, as well as several others who were active not only in North India but also in South India. They played very important role. They tried to bring harmony in the society, and the lower class who were downtrodden and neglected class, they also spoke about them. In this way, the Bhakti movement was in a way the egalitarian movement. When we enter into the Mughal period, this movement continued, but during this period, a kind of sannyasi cult developed, and this became more prominent in several parts of this country. So far as the sannyasi movement is concerned, sannyasi movement actually it originates from the Indian ashram system. Under the ashram system, the final stage of the ashram life is called sannyas. Bhakti or the sannyasi movement was not a mass movement. It was not even a movement for reforms in the entire society, nor was it a movement in which the common man, the masses, participated. Actually, this movement was an individual movement. It was the individual's participation. The socio-cultural movement that started in India, which came to be known as the Bhakti or the Sanyasi movement, was the purpose of this movement was to reconstruct the spiritual character, the spiritual ethos of the individual. In this way, this movement tried to reform and bring a kind of spirituality, which spirituality that was based on sympathy, liberalism, compassionate, and in this way, this movement, the sannyasi movement, tried to bring the people closer and to develop a kind of egalitarian society, because in this movement, the sannyasis particularly used not the Sanskrit language when they composed songs, when they wrote their poetry, or whatever they addressed to the people or the common man. Their language was not the Sanskrit language. Sanskrit language was in fact the language of the elitist people. But so far as the sannyasis were concerned, they used the language of the masses, the dialects, the folk languages. These languages were used by them. They used Odhi, they used Bhojpuri, they used Bengali language, as well as in Maharashtra, Marathi, Dakan, the Telugu language. These local languages were used by them. They never used Sanskrit language. In this way, by addressing the people through songs, through their poetry, they tried to bind the common man, the common people in the society. The Indian society was dominated by the caste system. The complexities of the rituals, the austerities of the Brahminical culture was such a strong that the general people did not have the free expression, the opportunity for free expression of their feelings and their emotions. In such condition, the Sanyasi movement, which adopted the common language as a vehicle of expression of their feelings and emotions, gave a free play to the common people as well as the sannyasis, so that they could be free from the complexities or orthodoxy of the Brahminical culture. In such condition, the Bhakti movement, the Sanyasi movement, gave an opportunity to the people to express their feelings, and this movement became popular in different parts of India. The different parts of India had the different type of offshoots of this Bhakti movement: Bengal, Maharashtra, North India, Gujarat, and other areas, particularly Kashmir. These areas were having different offshoots, different branches of this Bhakti and the Sanyasi movement. So far as the various offshoots are concerned, we find that the Tantric or Shakti cult, Eknath cult, as well as the Sahajiya cult, these three cults were very prominent. So far as the Shakti or Tantric cult is concerned, it spread into the Bengal. It was not that it was a new cult or it was a new spiritual movement in Bengal. The Shakti cult in Bengal is very old. The deity Durga, who is regarded as the deity or the symbol of power, was worshipped in Bengal for time immemorial. This type of cult spread later also, particularly during the Mughal period, it became more popular. And since during the early period, during the Sultanate period, we find that the Lord Chaitanya, who spread the cult of Krishna, the devotion for Krishna and Radha, was very important at that time. But later on, we see that this cult, the Krishna cult, which spread all over India, in Mathura, in Bengal, or in Vrindavan, and in other places, that became weak, and some other type of cults became prominent. Among them, in Bengal, the Shakti cult was very important. So far as the North India is concerned, there the Eknath cult became very important. The area which were under influence of this Eknath cult were the eastern UP, the areas which are now around Banaras, Jaunpur, or the western Bihar, as well as the borders of Nepal, were the under the influence of this cult. Under Eknath cult, the sannyasis stressed on the importance of monotheism, and under this monotheism, they spread the philosophies that God was one, and the creations, all the human beings, all the creations apart from human being, they all were the creation of God. In this way, this Eknath cult also became very significant in India, particularly in North India. Apart from this, there was the Sahajiya cult. Sahajiya cult was in fact a part of the Krishna cult, which stressed or which continued during the time of Lord Chaitanya. Later on, this Sahajiya cult, with some change, was also in existence and in practice in Bengal area. This Sahajiya cult, under this Sahajiya cult, the sannyasis stressed on the easy going and comfort of life. The term Sahajiya means easy, means the ease of the life, the comfort of the life, as well as the some sensual and philosophical practices started under this cult. In Bengal, Vidyapati, Chandidas, Chaitanya, Govindadas, these were the very important and leading exponent of the Bhakti and the Sanyasi cult. they stressed on the love and harmony of the people, and they stressed on the love cult of Krishna and Radha. So far as the Eknath cult was concerned, under Eknath cult, Gorakhnath was the leading exponent of this cult. He attacked the orthodox Brahmanism in eastern India, and he stressed that the people who were common masses, who were the creation of God, there should not be the difference between person and person, people and people, on the basis of their caste or their origin in the high class or the high caste family. Since the Eknath cult stressed on the popular monotheism, this cult became very popular in eastern India as well as in the North India also. So far as the Sahajya cult was concerned, this cult stressed on the materialistic enjoyment of life, though it originated from the Krishna cult of Chaitanya, but still this cult to some extent adopted or absorbed such elements in this cult that this cult not became very popular among the masses, because they such sannyasis, they smoke also, they drank also, and some of them took meat also. In such condition, this cult had certain ills in their practices, and due to these ills, due to these evil practices, this cult did not become very popular among the masses, but still this was also a cult, and this cult actually gave a kind of freedom which based on the individual expression and the individual thought. The Krishna cult based sannyasi movement spread in Maharashtra also. In Maharashtra, this cult was known as Varkari tradition or the Varkari sannyasis. The Varkari sannyasis were devoted to a deity whose name was Vitthal. Vitthal actually was a deity who was said to be the form of Lord Krishna. In this way, the Krishna cult, in a different local form and distinct from the Bengal's Chaitanya cult, was in practice in Maharashtra. This Varkari cult was very important because this cult also became popular among the common people, and the Marathi people particularly, they used to visit the Vitthal temple or the god Vitthal, and still the Vitthal word is very popular among the Marathi people. The child's name is kept Vitthal, and this Vitthal cult became very popular in Maharashtra. The particularly Gyandev was a person, and Eknath, the other sannyasi leader, these two were very prominent so far as this Varkari cult in Maharashtra is concerned. Eknath was born in Maharashtra in the year 1548 in Paithan, and Eknath was a scholar. He composed Bhagavad Gita Purana that became very popular in Marathi. Apart from Eknath, there was another sannyasi whose name was Namdev. It is said that he was a person who joined the group or the gang of dacoits, but later on he became the devotee of Vitthal or the form of Lord Krishna. In this way, Eknath, Namdev or Gyandev, all these were very important sannyasis who were related to the Varkari cult in Maharashtra. Another Varkari saint or sannyasi who was very popular in Maharashtra was Tukaram. He died very young in the year 1649. During this period, Tukanath became very popular because Tukaram composed poems which were devoted to the local deity Vitthal. Tukaram actually was a Shudra, and being a Shudra, belonging to a very lower caste in the society, he became very popular among the lower caste. But later on, his songs and his poems were appreciated by the people of the high class also, in which he gave a stress on the equality, particularly equality of being, under which the downtrodden, the Shudra class, the detached class of the society were also given a stress and significant in the society. Apart from the sannyasis, there were several sannyasini or the women saints who also played important role in the society, particularly during the Sultanate period as well as during the Mughal period. Discrimination and suppression of women, either as a wife, as a second wife, or as a young widow, was the basic or fundamental reason for the emergence of the women sannyasini. The women saint or sannyasini, they actually protested against the existing orthodox norms and behavior in the Brahminical or high class society in India. In such condition, the women, particularly young widow, who did not have any say or voice in the society, they were neglected, they were not having even respect in the society. Such type of women, or those who were married in the young age, but they did not get the same equal love and respect from his husband, who was comparatively old in age. Such type of women protested in the society. They left their house and they became sannyasini. And these sannyasinis, they became devotee to Lord Krishna, devotee to God. And these sannyasinis, they revolted against the established norm or the orthodox system of the Hindu-dominated Brahminical society in India. These sannyasinis, they left their houses and they began to reside under the precincts of the temples. They were devoted to Lord Shiva or Lord Krishna, and in such condition, these women whose behavior showed the protest, a kind of the overtones of protest was found in their behavior against the established Brahminical cult in the society. These sannyasinis or the women saint who left their houses and they began to recite inside the temple, they not only devoted themselves to Lord Krishna, and they accepted Lord Krishna as their divine husband, but they also composed poetry in praise of Lord Krishna. And these poems, these songs which they sang, these devotional songs which were related to Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva, became important element of the literature in India. Mirabai composed poems in Hindi, Akka Mahadevi composed poem in Kannada, as well as the Roop Bhavani composed poetry in Kashmiri language. So far as this literature are concerned, Kashmiri, Kannada, as well as Hindi and other other regional languages also, these sannyasinis, these women saints, they composed songs, And these songs became popular among the masses, among the common people, among the devotees, among the saints, and they began to sing these songs in public, in temples, and in this way, these sannyasini, through songs also, through their composition of poetry also, became popular among the masses, and this cult continued till the 18th century in India. Among these sannyasinis, Bhina Bai, who was born in Kolhapur in Maharashtra, was also very important. Bhina Bai was not only a sannyasini, but Bhina Bai was a very learned lady. She not only composed poems, but she was the only sannyasini in India who wrote her own autobiography. This autobiography was in Marathi and it became very popular among the mass. And apart from this, this sannyasini was very well received in the society. Apart from Bhina Bai, we should also have some idea regarding a Kashmiri saint, Kashmiri woman saint or sannyasini, whose name was Lal Dev. Lal Dev was so popular among the people that she was given the title of Maryam Makamni, or she was also known as Rabia Sani. Actually, Rabia Sani was a Sufi woman of Arabia, and this Lal Dev was given that name because this Lal Dev was popular among the Hindus as well as the Muslims. She was the devotee of Nuruddin Rishi. Nuruddin Rishi was very important so far as the Rishi or the Sanyasi cult was concerned, particularly in Kashmir area. This Rishi cult developed the syncretic cult in Kashmir and tried to harmonize the society, bring a kind of harmony among the Hindus and Muslims and other sects and in the society. In this way, the Rishi cult was also important, and these women played very important role, whether it was Lal Dev, whether it was Mirabai, whether it was Venubai, whether it was Akka Mahadevi. These played very important role as a sannyasini. They composed songs, and they one of them, particularly Venubai, wrote her autobiography also. Thus, we find that the Bhakti movement, which spread in India during the Sultanate period, in a different form, in a changed form, that form was related to the sannyasi cult, spread in other parts of India during the Mughal period. We find that under the sannyasi cult, the areas of eastern India, Bengal, Bihar and Assam, areas of Kashmir, areas of Gujarat as well as Maharashtra came under the influence. These sannyasis who renounced their family life, their society, they cut off from the established family norms, they started a kind of devotional journey under which they tried to realize the feeling of the absolute reality as well as the feeling, the love and the deep sense of realization of the main deity, whether it was Lord Krishna, whether it was Lord Shiva, and later on Lord Rama also came under the purview of this sannyasi cult, and they realized the spiritual existence, metaphysical contact with these deities, and in this way they tried to free themselves from the pangs of life. And at the same time, since they used the common language, the folk language, the language of the common masses, their cult became important, and the songs, the poetry which they composed, they also became important and popular among the common masses. In this way, we find that The sannyasi cult was also a cult based on love and harmony in the society. The distinction between upper caste and lower caste also faded due to the development and spread of this sannyasi cult